All right. Hey, y'all. Everybody getting their drawing setup done, getting your pencils out or your digital setup done, getting your iPad, getting everything ready. I'm Rashad Doucet, a professor at the Savannah College of Art and Design, professor in the sequential art department. That's just a big fancy word for comics, but also I mean we teach storytelling. And one of the big things about storytelling is obviously storytelling for a lot of mediums too. So like comics, storyboarding for movies, concept art, all that kind of stuff where we're designing characters and telling stories that, you know, effectively communicate an idea. And one of the best ways to do that is through, effective character design. When I see a lot of students when they're starting out, especially when you guys are in high school and figuring things out and you start drawing, dueling your own characters, is that a lot of them are, you know, like they're similar because you guys get good at like that one thing you know how to draw, which is great. But this is a little workshop to kind of help you using some basic shapes that we're all familiar with to kind of help you, you know, pull out some diversity and different kind of body types. Because if everybody looks the same when you're telling your story, like your epic vampire angel, whatever battle or whatever you're going to tell, you don't want your main character to look like your secondary character and so forth. Because they stand out more when they have their own unique looks. Even slight changes can help. And these kind of things that we're going to do today and get a little practice on today will help you do that effectively. And you can all just use basic shapes. So no matter what level you are drawing, we're going to use some shapes and we're going to start combining them. And as we go, we'll get a little bit more complex by the end of it. So it's like a little tiny version of what I do in one of my character design classes. So you can see here on the screen, this is a character I literally made up for this workshop. She was kind of fun to create using the same kind of thing. Got a lot of basic circles going on with the eyes, body type, head, things like that. The big guy in the back with the beard has, let's see what he has. He has a pointy nose, little triangle shapes, you know, that kind of stuff. And then I kind of like, this guy's like my Superman guy. Also gave him a triangle nose. But I want to go more into me in a second, and I want to give you guys an idea of what we're going to do before we start drawing. I'm a big fan of, you know, taking that time to think before you draw. I know that's kind of, sometimes it's kind of weird. Sometimes you have an imagination and you're doing what you got to do, but you want to make sure that you think before you start drawing to guide your actions. So let's go through it. So what I'm going to show you first is some of like the classic stuff, like how this is applied and things that you're familiar with. So got to go old school, got to show you the Looney Tunes characters. They are like a foundation for a lot of character design, cartooning. The creators who worked on this is like a newer version, I think like the 2000-ish, 8-ish kind of thing. But that being said, you can see the basic shapes all through here. Look at Bugs' feet here, those kinds of things. The characters themselves are also kind of big shapes, like just not always like perfect squares or perfect triangles, but you can see here that you can see this big shape of this guy. What's this guy called? I forget his name, the hairy dude. Somebody Instagram me. What's the hair? I forget his name. This is sad. That's just sad. You know, I'll keep going. But it's important because before I move on, it makes you, like I said, your portfolio more diverse, makes your characters more diverse. It makes your story stand out more. And that's why you want to try to get better at it. It also gets big and small companies looking at it. So they go, oh, wow, look at that. That's a little diverse thing. All your characters look a little different. That's good. Another show that I know a lot of you are familiar with and probably just finished watching is Steven Universe. And I think they've done a great job of showing you a variety of different body types using very simple shapes. I mean, Garnet's head here. Let's see, got a chat, let's make sure. Okay, cool. All right. Garnet's head here. It's basically a square. Look at that square. Steven is mostly circles. Look at his hair. I love the hair. I love the volume in the hair. Amethyst has that big hair too. Just some all around, just letting you know. And my girl Pearl in the back, you know, I grew to love Pearl. Wasn't always a Pearl fan, but now I am. Like, you know, I'm a big Pearl fan in the grand scheme of things. Haven't finished up the newest version of the show yet, but I want to show you some other stuff from the show. So one of the big things I like about this show, and this is what the lineup you would look like, right? So you're designing your own characters at home. You're thinking about what you're going to do. Your goal should be this. Like when you look at the lineup, all the characters laid up in front of each other, everybody looks kind of unique. There are some repeating patterns, but everybody has a unique look. And that's something we strive for with our students and our classes, but also in my own work, which I'll introduce in a second. But you want to make sure that you think about that and look at the shapes and look at those simple things and look at those, look how those bodies look different, make everybody stand out, memorable. That's a fan for everybody in here. All right, let's keep going there. This is another example from Paranormal, another professional example. What I like about this one is this guy. He is literally a T-shape. Look at him. No waste. You know, no waste. You guys watch the movie Paranorm. It's one of those stop motion movies. Great movie. But that being said, like, look at that. Like, right? T-shape. This dude over here is pretty much a box. Look at that nice square with just, like, legs, which it could be sticks. You know, when you're starting out, it could just be sticks. You just pop them on there. Little circles here and there. And we'll break those down. So there's that little example from there. And this is one of my other favorite examples, looking at Zootopia. So it doesn't matter really your style. I know some people are like, well, I draw this kind of style, do this kind of thing. You can still make it work. Sometimes a little bit more, you know, exaggerated than not. But if you look at it, if you get a base, you know, head shape, and then if you just get a base body shape, like you use a circle for a body, a square for a body, you can get a variety of different things. If you look at just all the animals here, they basically all have like these little square shapes. If you can study them there, and we'll zoom in on them, but like basically a little square, little teardrop bodies, and then you add heads and legs on them, which could be sticks and circles or squares and circles, and you get a body. And you get a variety of different bodies, depends on the size of that head, how long you make those arms, whether you squares or more circles, like those kinds of things will give you different types of characters. And as you get better, of course, you start fine-tuning this and making that anatomy more consistent. But at this stage, it's just good to get a good sense of that to make them more unique. This is another example of how that difference really stands out. So this is two examples, right? We have the Teen Titan from like an old Teen Titans cartoon from before most of us were around. I think it was like 60s, 70s, maybe 80s. I don't know. It's an old drawing that I found. And don't get me wrong, it's a good drawing, right? Like a lot of you have great foundation. You know what you're doing. But when I look at the cast, you know, the top image, right? You look at the cast and they all have the same, you know, the same body type. Cyborg's a little bit taller, but everybody else is around the same height, the same thickness. So they don't stand out as much. But when you look at the bottom row, right, you get to see, like in the Teen Titans cartoon, not Teen Titans Go, but the Teen Titans one right before it, which is now a classic, which is crazy. I remember when it came out, so age is creeping up on me, like oh man, stay away. I remember when that was a new show, like, but now it's a classic. A lot of y'all, but look at the shapes, right? Look at Cyborg, right? Now Cyborg stands out. Yes, he's still the big one, but he also has different shapes. Look at Robin, look at Beast Boy. They have similar body types, but they have definitely more uniqueness in terms of how the proportions and the head weights and the feet and things like that. That's the things you guys want to try to think about when you're designing your own stuff. And I know that's complex, so, and before we get too much into the drawing part, these are, like I said, all starts with shape. This is me. Hey, I'm Rashad. How you doing? This is actually me 10 years ago, I think, or when I'm closer in my early 20s. Let's just say early 20s. And I want to tell you a little bit about myself before we get into it. I'm real big and letting you guys know who you're learning from and what they've done. And so you can see that and look that up. But I started out, like, my childhood, I lived in Eunice, Louisiana. And then I also went to school in Ville Platte, Louisiana, which is two little small towns in about the middle, a little south of Louisiana there. Then I spent my high school years and some early college years in New Orleans. I started freelancing, I think my second year of college. It was a different college, University of New Orleans. And I started freelancing. First convention, got lucky, landed a small gig, started doing work for people. And that was fun. And I've been doing comics ever since. I've been freelancing. I've never stopped freelancing. I've been freelancing since I was, 21, I think. And so, like I said, and I tried to take this photo, trying to be cool. My sister took this photo. It didn't work. I'm a big fan of X-Men, Superman, Dragon Ball. What's that? Naruto or Boruto's dad? Boruto's dad? Is that what we call him now? Boruto's dad? I don't know. But I'm a big fan of all those guys. I need to maybe shave my head again and go back to this look. Some of my work. So here you go. This is one of my first major graphic novels. It's called Alabaster Shadows. It's about this little kid here in the middle, the big afro. He moves into a new town, have to solve HP Lovecraft monsters are invading the town, which in hindsight now that's gotten so much more popular. This came out about 5 years ago now. But that's gotten grown. It's like a kid horror series. We was not too scary parents for the little ones out there. We were very aware of that. There was a monster I had to cut because it was a little too scary. So we got rid of it. But it's these kids trying to save their parents, essentially. The parents get kind of caught up in this thing, and the kids are trying to find ways by going to different worlds and dealing with this all kind of stuff and saving their parents from getting caught there. This is some more mainstream work here that I've done outside of my own work that I helped create. This is the ones that I've worked for. So licensed work I've done for others. So for example, Invader Zim, those covers are always fun. I love working on Invader Zim. and get to do some a little bit of character design. I didn't update, obviously, change anything, because you can for those kind of jobs. However, it was just a fun thing. I designed that gun. That was kind of fun to see. I was thinking like some old 90s superheroes that had those huge guns or ridiculous that didn't look like anything real and fun and sci-fi. So I wanted to get the same thing for Zim trying to be tough, but it's too heavy for him. And then there's a Rick and Morty one. I just really wanted Rick in a rainbow and Rick being Rick with a rainbow. That was like the hugest inspiration for this cover. Like, must draw it with sparkles. Just thought that would be hilarious because he would hate it, right? So that was fun designing that and working with Cartoon Network, Adult Swim, and Oni Press there. That was some good times. One more example. I got a couple more. This is a children's book that I just did. Came out last year. Jeremiah Justice Saves the Day. It's about a special needs kid who has a tracheostomy tube, which he can funnel his superpower through, and he kind of like uses wind blast, super tornado blast, as you like to call it, to save Savannah. It's actually based in Savannah. He fights crime there in cute, fun ways. It was a fun book to work on. It was actually a charity project, which people are still, hopefully people can donate to. If you buy the book, the money goes there. So that's great. Easily find on Amazon. This is not a plug. I just want to talk about it because it is a charity, and I actually liked working on it. It was real fun. All right. So that's enough about me talking about me. Oh, wait, I have a question. Hold on. Ooh. Oh, shadowing. Well, what's that, Fritz? We'll try to get to that. Let me get some of this basic faces done, and then we'll do some shadow stuff. It's a little bit easier for me to do it on my computer. But the main thing for you to think about is to pick up a basic lighting source. So right now, like the light's coming from maybe my right of the screen for you guys. You'd want to make sure all the shadows stay to the other side. So I will do that. Just, write me again when we get to the drawing parts a little bit, like after the first two examples, and I'll show you a quick way to do it using a pencil, or if you're using a computer, a way to do it that way as well. But that being said, let's get started with some, just some examples of what I'm talking about, right? Some examples. And Fritz, we'll get back to making it more realistic too. There's a way to do it. Might have to just message me after this is all done, but we can, we can go into that too to help you to combine these two things. But to start out, let's say you're trying to do some cartoony stuff and trying to make sure you have a nice base. The basic circle can get you so far. It really gets you far. One of the ways I practice this, and I have my students do this sometimes as a warm-up, one of my first assignments in one of my character design classes is actually doing a bunch of these with different shapes. But what you do is you take one basic shape, which is a circle in this case, and you can make up shapes too. It gets kind of crazy when you make like wonky shapes. We'll try one out and see what happens a little bit later. But you take a basic shape, and then you just try to see how many faces you can make with that one shape. You can add whatever you want to add, but you try not to break that circle too much, right? So with this one, it's like a little kid's face. And this one with all circles and half circles. It's a half circle, but for the ears, half circle for the ears, half circles for the eyes, some basic things there. And then I added some hair on top. I want to make a note about hair really quick. I also see that a lot of students, when they're starting out, like to draw all these crazy strands. And I'm going to demo this in a second, but all these crazy strands of hair, it gets wild and you hurt your hand, you scratch it into your paper. You want to think about shape and volume first, even if you're going to add detail later. You want to think about shape and volume. You want to think about, like what that hair kind of looks like. Don't let it be wild with the strands of hair. Yes, hair is made of strands, but you want to make sure you have a shape to contain it. And then you start adding those lines in there. So you have like a, kind of gives you like a little playground to work in for the hair. So I always use volume for hair before, no matter how detailed I might get later, adding, like details and stuff like that. So then we go to different types of faces here. So we have this kind of grinning evil guy here and then that guy. And I'm gonna show you how to draw it. It's kind of fun. But the point being is taking a basic shape and seeing how many different faces can you get without doing it. Don't just make everybody young. Try to think about old, think about balding, think about robots, think about monsters, think about whatever you want, but try to keep it in that shape. Another example of it, triangles, right? I love using triangles. It's a little bit harder, especially when doing heads. We're gonna start with heads and then we'll get to bodies too. But triangle is a little bit harder because you have to like kind of cut into it a little bit. So I kind of made like this little robot samurai dude head, this lady smiling, and you want to just play around once again with using the basic shape and see how many things you can get out of it. Well, tips for shortening, we'll try a little bit of that once again. I'll draw one for you. That'll be a little bit harder to do really quickly. But yes, I can probably throw that one in there too towards the end. And then body shapes. The same method as I did with the heads, you do with the body. So you take a basic shape, triangle, square, or a weird little teardrop shape that I like to use. And then you just let your imagination run free and try to add as much as you can to it. Arms, legs, knees, whatever you want to add. I tend to have fun. These are great warm-ups for me. And this is about imagination flow. So that's what we're going to do next. But the reason why, and here's why this is so important as a storyteller, as a character designer, working on shows, working at Disney, Pixar, things like that one day. Now Netflix, big place to work at. You want to make these iconic shapes that stand the test of time. And you can recognize every one of these characters here for a reason. And that's important. You definitely don't start out this way. Like, you don't just make a classic character, but you want to make sure that you are looking at this kind of stuff and seeing that's my goal and throwing it out there. And that's because you're playing around with shapes to not just have everybody look the same there. All right, so let's go through some drawing. Let me stop sharing for a quick second and open up my program. And for those of you, who are, share, and now I need this one. Sorry, guys. There we go. And for those of you at home, so there's two things I need you to do to get ready for this. The first thing is that you need to, hold on, let me open up the, it'll pop up again. The first thing you need to do is get your paper ready. If you're working at home on traditional paper, if you're working on any program, whether using Clip Studio or if you're using Photoshop or using Procreate, I know a lot of you guys yet, Fire Alpaca. Just make a new layer. You don't want the layer. I have a white background, but it just always kind of just like, I like to just draw in white because it reminds me of traditional paper. It's kind of my thing. I know some people don't like doing that, but it's one of my favorite things to do. You want to make sure that you, I want to move this. There we go. Perfect. Make a new layer before we start drawing. So just make sure you have a new layer ready to go. And now get my pencil ready and I'll make a new layer. I've been practicing I was practicing a little bit before we got started. So let's give you an example of just starting with a basic shape. We're gonna start with a circle. And I might have to turn my screen a little bit and see a little bit closer to me here, but I'm just gonna start with a circle. Get a little closer. There we go, perfect. All right, so this is a circle, right? Now this is important. Like I said, no matter how detailed you want to be later, this is important to start with these fundamentals. I know some of you think, well, I've got it. No, none of us got it. So let's work along with me and you'll get there to where you need to be. So one of the important things when you start with a circle, you don't just start drawing faces and stuff. You don't just start doing that, right? You don't do that. What you do first, a simple little thing you do, right? And I like to use a colored blue pencil or a pencil of a different color. So if you're working on traditional paper, even if you use a colored blue, the reason why, when you go back to clean it up, like an ink pen or whatever, markers or whatever, you can always, like, you know, the light blue or whatever, or the light red or whatever color you end up using, you can just go over it. It helps you draw loose and tight. One of my methods of teaching is that you start off like crazy big and then you kind of like tighten it up to make it look nice and nice and pretty. You don't just start edging away early. Let's see, you've got a question. Oh, let's pop it up. Chat. Oh, thank you. this program that I'm using here is called Clip Studio Paint. You could use Photoshop too, but I'm just a huge fan of this particular program. It used to be called Manga Studio, and I found that it was just really fun to work in for me. The cool thing about programs now is that there's a lot of options. I don't think one is better than the other one. It's really about what works for you. It's kind of like choosing your different style of paintbrush. Ultimately, all paint. Ultimately, every pencils. But it's finding that program that really speaks to you. And at school, we have access to Clip Studio too, as well as Photoshop. So you can get access to both of these things on the school computers when you need them, and they're, you know, easily accessible, that kind of thing. But for me, it's always Clip Studio. So anyway, going with the circle. Let's move this there. All right, you want to cross. I'm gonna do one in the middle. You wanna make these little T shapes. Super important. I'll make a new layer so I can turn it on and off. You want to start there. The reason for this, right? So if I'm drawing a bunch of heads, right? You can turn the eyes around based on where you put this, right? And it keeps it consistent. One of the things about drawing anything, illustration, storytelling, things like that, sequential art, is that you want to keep those character designs and those faces the same at different shots, different angles, different views, different whatever. You want to make sure you do that. So here we go. And then you just start adding. So I'm gonna just add these real fast here so you can see kind of what I'm talking about. All I'm using is still basic circles, right? But this line is super important. You wanna make sure you get that line. Here's why. So let me turn this one off, right? And let's say I want somebody, so the first person I drew was like very middle based, like perfectly centered, right? So let's draw a second person, right? Now the eyes are a little bit lower. This person is grumpy, doesn't wanna be on Instagram Live, it's sad. But it has nice hair. And a triangle nose, right? So there's that. Let's see, let's show you another shape though. Let's get these guys out of the way. Let's try a triangle shape. Same thing, we'll make a couple of triangle shapes and see what we come up with, right? So circles for eyes, always on those lines. The nose and the mouth goes on this line. And then I'm gonna give this person a really big kind of square nose. Look at that. Oh, this guy's fun. I like wild hair. Okay, let's, you know, there we go. This guy's happy to be here. He's got like a little awkward smile, some big teeth. So that's fun. Half circles for ears, circles for eyes there. Now with this second one, we'll go lower. And I'm gonna do an oval shape. So I kind of do like an oval shape for the eye here, right? And then I'm gonna turn this into hair. Now this lady, now I'm gonna round her out. If I was doing actually a full design, I would round this out. So there we go. So that way she doesn't look too much like the cone heads or whatever, if you guys remember the cone heads. Yeah, look at that. She's coming together. Where's she going with that hair? We can probably shave that down. Now, sometimes when I'm like editing, since we're doing a few steps in advance, I notice we're gonna run out of time. You can chop that down just a little bit. Once you got the shape that you want down. She still has a more, you know, triangular shape here and there, but we just chopped it down to make it more fun. But you just use these shapes as a starting point. Let's do, so I'm gonna get to some of those questions. Let's try now with a full body. So this is one of my favorite full body shapes. I'm gonna do just kind of like pear shapes. It's good for cartoon characters, like Donald Duck. And you should, I would say start with your head, you know, like start with the head first. But in this case, I'm going to not do that. Just to show you the shapes here. All right. And let's go back to pencil. Got it. Let's get some big ears. Look at that. Who's this big eared person? And a tie and a belt. Now I wanna connect them all together. I'm trying to think of a way. Let's give them a scarf. There we go. And now this little person exists using some basic shapes. So you can have a lot of fun with it. So some questions early. So I wanna make sure that, well, we answer some of those questions earlier, because that's pretty much it, guys. Just take your time and don't draw as fast as me when you learn how to do this. Take your time, start with a shape, and let's get with some more detailed ones, because Fritz had the question of like making a little bit more detail. How would you go about doing that? And some foreshortening things too. So I'm gonna start with that circle shape, but I'm gonna add kind of like, I don't know, what would you call this? A melting rectangle. Let's add a little shape there, and then I'm gonna add eye. So this is gonna get a little bit less cartoony, but still cartoony. Oval shape for eyes, circles for pupils, half circles for eyebrows, and different types of noses, right? So like, for example, big round nose, or we can go triangular. And you can change up. Even if you have the same head type, you can get a variety of different characters just from doing that. One of the classic ones is that for my anime folk. I'm gonna go with round nose for the fun of it today. And now I'm gonna color this one, put some shadows on it for you, Fritz, to get this idea. Oh wait, got another one, hold on. Oh, yes. Any tips for drawing boys? Yes, we do. We definitely do. Matter of fact, I'm drawing a boy now. Same kinds of things. Adding. So start a new one so we can show that in person. So drawing a full shape for a kid. Let's say a little kid, right? So I'm gonna start with a round head. Add little rectangles for a neck. Little rectangle for a body, right? Half circles for ears. I like drawing people with ties, kind of my thing. I'm wearing one. And you don't want to make the legs too long. You want to kind of keep them a little, I'm gonna give them some shorts. Let's give them some shorts. Yep. And so like, I would draw the full, like kind of like rectangles here, and then add little circles, half circles for feet. Let's have his hands in his pockets. He'll have long arms for the sake of our drawing. But if you don't want to give him that, you can always have him just kind of wave out here. There's his shirt. And then once again, doing what we did earlier, using those cross lines, right? And I'm going to give him big hair because I'm a fan of big hair. So basic shapes you're using, squares, rectangles, half circles that kind of, or little blobby circles there, and you get like a little guy. Going back with those questions there, see if I can get a little shadows for you, Fritz, before we hang up. Wait, got another question. Any tips for using shapes to draw hair? That's a good question. You know where I get that from? Like I watch, like, if you look up, there's a old Japanese animator's name is Osamu Tezuka. He did create this character called Astro Boy, and he had these crazy shaped hairs, right? And so I use that. So what I would do first is always start with some kind of basic shape, and I'm kind of cutting into it to show you guys, right? And then I think about how, like, I would do that on new layer or with another pencil paper, a different colored pencil, if that helps, and play around with what do I kind of want this hair to look like, right? So in this case, maybe really spiky, because I tend to always do that. But I just try to make a shape. I have fun. And I looked at it from looking at old Tezuka things. Like, he always had like these crazy spiked hairs. And you don't always have to go that way. You can always follow the shape of the head too and give somebody a hair that's like shoulder length, and things like that. Yeah, she's fun to draw. Yeah, so you think about having like, play around with more shapes. Like, how do I want this hair to look? So if you're looking at a photo, right? She has long hair in the photo, or he has short hair in the photo. Try to see if you can get the contour of that hair before you go in and draw, you know, on top of the head. Draw it in there before you start adding lines to it and things like that. Going back to our one of our original questions, though, because I do want to show you guys really quick. A quick way to shadow. So I'm going to make a new layer. And this works on any program you're working on. Or if you're doing traditional paper, get a different color pencil if you need to. I'm going to turn my opacity down. And what you want to usually do is, let me get the right program here. I'm going to have to do it the old fashioned way. All right, I'll just do it the other way. But what you want to do is give yourself a good bit of space to shadow. So I like to kind of like shadow out, like I like to plan my shadows. Like, this is really dark, so I'm gonna plan out where my shadows are, and I can mess with this and erase it down later. But I'm gonna plan out my shadows. So what that means is I'm thinking about what the direction of the light. The light's coming from here. I'm gonna turn that down, get some of this, get a little bit. And now the thing about, trick about this is you need to know your positions on the face. Like, you need to know where in the face you are, where the, like, the contours of the face are. So it's a little anatomy practice with that. And you want to kind of, you know, base the light from there. So I'm gonna just erase a little bit here and use a different eraser. So you can kind of see, soft eraser. There we go. Yeah, okay. Ooh, running out of time. Okay, so I'm gonna erase it down just a little bit so you can see a little bit better, but always blocking my shadow. So essentially, no matter you're working on a computer program or you're working at home, you want to block in the shadows before you go in and start like trying to get rid of them. I'm a block in and erase kind of guy, and I figure out, you know, and I might put it back here just in a little bit to kind of see what it looks like. But let's see here. There we go. Just to kind of see some shapes there. And that's pretty much there. Let's see. Woo. We can go an extra 10. Yes, Kyle, that would be great. Yes, give me an extra 10. Right. Ooh, man, you guys got some evolved questions. I love it. Let's do that. All right. So First, talking about foreshortening, and this helps with line of action as well. This is a great question. Favorite animated character of all time? Before I get to that one, that's an easy one. I say that. It's Superman. I say it's easy. I'm struggling. I'm not. It's Superman. But I also like Storm of the X-Men. Like, when I was a little kid, my favorite action comic character was Storm of the X-Men. My first dog's name was Storm. But then as I got older, I like Superman because he's so freaking noble, and that just inspires me. Currently, All Might, though, I like All Might a lot. Big fan of All Might. Okay, from My Hero Academia. Just, once again, noble guy. Right, so thinking about foreshortening. So I'm going to draw a little bit faster here. So what you want to do, let me just give you a body just to show you, for example. You got to think about these directional lines. Right, I'm going to make his feet kind of wrap up at the bottom. So you make this little triangle shape. Make this out of the way. Make this little triangle shape, which is like a rough idea of a vanishing point. So there's a little bit of perspective involved, which is a lot of questions people were asking earlier too. You want to make sure that you give yourself a little bit of space to that, because that could be a lot of things. This is my vanishing point. This is the stuff. And my character is going to fit inside of that. So I'm going to draw a quick character for you here. Somebody just walking with spiky hair, because I'm a fan. This person's a little sneaky. They're up to something. Big jacket. Ooh, maybe they're a wizard. Wizard staff? Yeah, wizard. And you just try to make sure that when you're doing line of action or if you're doing like perspective, you want to make things recede. And it's kind of weird learning that because you're on a 2D plane, right? So, is that better? Okay. 2D plane, right? So you want to make sure that you make the things that are big, things that are closer to the eye, bigger, and things that are smaller, forward. So when I'm drawing these feet, which is a basic example here, I'll make the foot that stands out more, and I'm gonna overdo it. I'm gonna pull it out, right? It's gonna stand out more. And then when that's not the case, and the foot in the behind it is a little bit smaller, it fits into that. It shrinks as we go more into the foreground. So when you're doing something even more dynamic, it comes in handy. So if I'm doing some guy running really fast, big fro, right? I'm doing the same thing, but all I'm actually adding is just a little bit more dynamicism. So the triangle is kind of doing this thing, right? I'm fitting him this way. So his bigger parts are coming up here. His tinier parts are fitting down there. I think that's a good bit. We're wrapping up. So we got like a few minutes before that. Does anybody have any questions about anything? As I said, always start with a basic shape as a review and just add to the basic shape. You can make almost anything you want just thinking about something simple. I want to give this guy a little beard and a mustache. Oh, he's like a gnome now. He's a little gnome guy. Look at that. That's fun. Have I missed any questions? Anybody else have anything they want to know? Let's see. I'm going to go over some of these let me see if I miss anything. No, I think that's pretty good. Let's end on something kind of fun. Let me draw something a little bit more detailed for you guys so you can see kind of like an advanced version of this before we wrap up. I want to draw Inuyasha because Inuyasha is coming back. Well, or the daughters are coming back. But, well, let's make this person happy. We don't need all these frowning folk. There we go. Better. Yes, that is. That is very, very, very good question. How do you decide what clothing your character should wear? What you think about is definitely the personality. A good example of this, and I always look at it, is how, and also not just the clothes they wear, but also how they carry themselves. So, like, how they act. So, for example, look at Scooby-Doo, look at Fred and Shaggy. No matter what version of Scooby-Doo you're dealing with, Shaggy acts a certain kind of way, Fred acts a certain kind of way, right? So when Fred is scared, he's scared happy, he's scared with a prowl. Like, if you look at all Fred drawings, his chest is always out. So when he's afraid in a confident way, whereas in Shaggy, loses it. And it goes with their clothes too. Fred wears tight-fitting, form-fitting clothes because he plays off his physique based on his personality, where Shaggy would wear loose Baggy clothes because Shaq is a little insecure. You know, maybe not so comfortable with his body, those kinds of things. Maybe just not there yet. You know, Shaggy's a little all over the place, not put together, well kept. So you do think about personality. That is a great, great question. So short answers, think about that. And the way to do that, though, you still have to look at a lot of stuff, though. You can't just, like, keep it all in your head. I have a Pinterest board and a few other things. I have, like, just different clothing styles in, like, a photo reference section, or just drag them to your phone or your desktop. And you just take a bunch of references. I look at a lot of fashion magazines. I'm a huge fan of all that kind of stuff. See what people wearing in different time periods, and then, like, sketching that stuff out. So when I start designing characters, I start pulling from those things. Any websites recommendations for pose references? One to look for that I dislike, and, you know, it's not a website directly. They're just called Japanese pose books, like action pose books, like are definitely, like, I would look those up because they give you so many different examples of different types of people, like people sitting down, people fighting. There's different types. I'm a big fan of that. But really, just Pinterest, like, just type in whatever reference pose you're looking for in Pinterest, and they'll give you an endless list of things, and you can just start saving them, and it's easier. I know there's some that times you, and that's a good practice. There's a lot of different ones for that one. Any one of them does work. As long as you're timing yourself and trying to get those doodles done in a certain amount of time, it'll work fine. We got about 4 minutes left. So anybody else, any other questions about anything you want to know? Always feel free to hit me up too outside of this, whatever you, I'm always open. Just hit me up and we will talk more if you have art questions. I'm a big fan of talking to you guys. I get super excited talking about this, as you can tell. I'm thinking kind of like in my head as I had to draw this, like Hermione a little bit, right? Hermione, Harry Potter a little bit. Let's get a tree back here, right? Now we didn't talk about backgrounds, but here's that foreshortening thing we were talking about earlier. Some stuff like that here. If not, we can wrap up in a second. So I'm just adding a tree, some sun. I've been into Twilight lately, so I should have probably just drew some Twilight stuff. This huge Twilight fan. Now I am. Crazy enough. That wraps it up. But remember, the things to remember, as always, is think about, no matter how detailed you're going to get, believe me, those basic shapes, if you look at anatomy books really well, you'll see that it all starts, all the muscle groups that you will draw in detail still have basic shapes based into them. You're essentially just layering. Cartooning, we kind of simplify it, but you're always layering shapes on top of each other, and you want to learn it. For line of action, you want to think about contour and form too, and gesture. So you want to get that gesture right, but then you want to make sure you know that contour. No matter if you're going super complex or super simple, like Pop-Up Girls, it still is a complex drawing, whether or not, I know it doesn't seem like it, but posing it that way. I think that's it for me. It's hard to tell. Like, does anybody have anything else want to ask in the comment section? I wish I had time to color these. Oh, okay. All right. Well, it's been fun, guys. Hit me up on Instagram if you have any more questions. I hope you guys had a good time. It was fun for me. I like talking and drawing literally all day. Have a good one.